I got a letter from Luis Buñuel, and in that letter he was offering me to work on the adaptation of the Joseph Kessel novel, Belle de Jour. I didn't know the book. And Louis Malle told me, you shouldn't do that. I mean, Belle de Jour has been refused by so many directors. It's already a very cheap novel. There's no interest at all. But in the Louis letter, there were a few words, a few indications, quite mysterious, that, you know, convinced me that I had to accept, that he was not going to describe a whorehouse, but to try to go inside the secrets of the main character. I think we did two or three different versions, one in Madrid, another one in Mexico a few months later, as we used to do all the time. And the film was normally shot in Paris. You know, we used to work for, let's say, 5-6 weeks on a first draft, and then to stop for 3-4 weeks to meet again, you know, and so to work on a second version and so on. When we start working on Belle de Jour, I had asked two friends of mine, two journalists, to make sort of inquiry, investigation about the secret prostitution in Paris. And with Buñuel in Madrid, we went through two or three brothers, elegant ones. Always there was a lady who was receiving us with some whiskey and two or three girls around, you know, just listening. And we were able to ask questions about, you know, how is it going, how does it go, what do the clients ask for. The reason why the Hakim brothers were involved in that film is that Silverman had gone bankrupt, you know, 2 years before, and couldn't finance any more film. Later, he will come back for the Milky Way and all the other Buñuel films. But for Belle de Jour, it's the only one that was produced by another French producer than Serge Silverman, the Hakim brothers. The Hakim brothers were classical producers. You know, they were not interested at all in Buñuel's work. I mean, they even didn't know exactly what he had done before. But that sort of ignorance of the producers sometimes gives the director and the author a sort of freedom, you know, to do exactly what they want to do. Belle de Jour is a film about prostitutes and prostitution, and where you don't see one naked tit. You know, nothing, absolutely nothing. Probably they were quite disappointed. They had probably hoped that the film would be, at the time, scandalous, you know, would be something erotic, even maybe pornographic in a way, you know. The first surprise came when they read the script. You know, I'm not sure they quite understood what we wanted to do, you know, going from the so-called reality to the so-called imagination. After the film went to Venice and won the Golden Lion in Venice, all the problems were solved. The moment we start working on a script, whatever the script, we don't know where we are going. We have absolutely no idea of what the film, what the script is going to be at the end and what the film is going to be after the script. So we start working, and step by step, you can't avoid to ask you the question, why is she doing this? What, you know, obliged her to go? And step by step, talking with friends, with a lot of women, with some analysts and psychoanalysts, we found out that she was probably what we call a masochist, and that was her secret. The film is the real portrait of a masochist. It went so far that Jacques Lacan, the famous psychoanalyst, when he was talking in his lectures and lessons about feminine masochism, would just show Belle de Jour and say, I have nothing more to say.
Moi aussi, cet homme-là, il me ferait peur. Des fois, ça doit être pénible tout de même. Qu'est-ce que tu en sais, Pallas?
In the book, there is absolutely no daydreams, no imaginations that really belong to the film. We try to select the daydreams and the imagination that would go with in that same direction. All the daydreams in the film has been told to us by women. We would never dare of inventing women eroticism. The more we went, the more we realized that what is called the reality in the film, which means a relation with her husband, friends, you know, all this sort of social life, was totally artificial in the novel. And we wanted to keep it artificial in the film. The only reality in the film is in the daydreams. You know, it's like going upside down with reality and imagination. What looks real is false. One huge part of the history of the cinema is based on a conflict, on a fight, on a struggle between the director, the author of the film, and the reality. You know, how shall I deal with that reality which is so imposing, you know, so strong, so hard to beat? You know, that's the case in Belle de Jour. And there are many allusions, the sexual allusions in the text, but in the image, you don't see anything. This is one of the secrets of the film. We were looking at the end for a moment where reality and reality would meet and maybe mix for a moment, you know. We were looking for that, and vainly for a long time. And one night, I remember at maybe 2 o'clock in the morning, Buñuel called me, which usually he never did, and asked me, could you come to my room? I think I have an idea for the end. So I put a cloth on, I went to his room, and he was almost crying, very moved, when he told me something which is not this ending, but almost close to this ending. And in the middle of the night, we start working together until we find that it's a very delicate balance, you know, between what we can understand, what we cannot, to end with the, you know, the carriage empty that passes. Clearly, there is no possible explanation. You know, it's a moment when we leave the characters, the two characters, her husband and her, with their secret. Did it happen something before or not? Was the story, the whole story, faked, a lie, something that we just made out, you know, like this? No, nobody can say, you know, that's one of the charm, discrete charm of the film. It's probably the number one commercial success of Buñuel, of all the Buñuel films. He wasn't so very happy about it. I mean, because he said, and I said, that it was probably for bad reasons. That people at that time were going to see a film with whores. For instance, at that time it was forbidden in Spain. But in the city, in the French cities near Spain, like Perpignan and Bayonne, the film had an incredible success because Spanish people were crossing the borders to come and see the film. So the film was released in Bayonne and Perpignan for months and full all the time, you know. And probably some of them went back disappointed because there is nothing much to watch in the film. Beginning when the film was shown, you know, in 66, 67 to some of my friends like Rimal, like Volker Schlöndorff, we went to see it together, they were quite dumbfounded. I mean, they didn't find Buñuel, the Buñuel of Viridiana, and, you know, the Buñuel violent and cruel, and they didn't find any sort of Romanesque atmosphere, you know. They were sort of taken by surprise, you know. But then the years went by, and the film grew in our memory. I saw the film a few months ago, and it was like a new vision of the film.